Okay, everybody, welcome back to the second part of my tutorial on how to create a Let's Play. Well, actually, now what we're going to try and do is bring up an existing project that has audio and video already prepared for production, just so I can show you kind of what you need to do if you have multiple tracks for commentary and video and, you know, any other particular things that you'd want to add to your production. So I'm going to go ahead and go to Open Project here, and we're not going to save this one. We'll use one of my Brave Fencer Musashi episodes, and we'll just go ahead and pick one of these here. It may take a little bit to load, since these files are actually fairly large. It takes a little bit to prepare all the components. So an interesting thing to note is that you get pretty decent control over each one of the tracks individually, so you can change the volume levels to better suit your audience or where you're going to be producing it. So if you happen to record the audio from the console at a much louder range than you do your microphone voice, your microphone capture, which is almost always the case that it records quietly, depending on what you're using, it may be beneficial to you to individually control the volume levels for each track so that it will better suit the final product. And as you can see here, we have our audio and video track and then our commentary track, and we can do things to each one by locking the individual track from any action. So if we don't want, for instance, to affect the volume level of the audio and video, we'll go ahead and hit the lock button over here, and then we can unselect the audio too, and then we can do volume up and down by clicking these buttons here, and you can see that the sound waves have gotten smaller to indicate that the volume level has been decreased. So if we need to increase our voice recording volume, we can do so here, and then we can preview what we've done so far by just going ahead and, you know, selecting different parts throughout the video and hitting the play button.
Hide it for us.
So that you can help sync up your text and your video. And that's actually something that is unfortunate should you be capturing your audio and your commentary from different sources, is that they're not coupled together. So you have to make sure that to prevent desyncing, that you know you have reference points for when you have made comments during a certain part in the video, so that you can line the two tracks up properly so that it appears as though it was all recorded from one source. So oftentimes what you'll do when you start your recording is you'll give yourself some space at the beginning and the end of each clip so that if you need to clip one or the other, it'll be easy to do that. And for the audio tracks, they're not stationary, so you can also move them around like this, which gives you some room to change when the audio will come in. And then if you decide to move it to a later spot, your audio will follow. As such. So that can be useful for splicing together two different tracks to produce one when you finally produce. You can also do things like selecting ranges of each track so that if you need to do any cutting or editing or muting or whatever, you can lock the tracks that you don't want cut. And let's say we have some, we'll actually move this one out here. And let's pretend like we had some, you know, like I said, leaving yourself a buffer zone at the beginning of each track. If we don't want that anymore, we can highlight that section and click the scissors button here, which will cut the selection from the video, and it will eliminate any extraneous clip time, and it will also help if your video happens to be a little longer than it should have been. And as you can see in this particular example, we're still 12 seconds over the YouTube time limit, so that can be helpful for when you need to, you know, make cuts or whatnot. And I think now, that's basically, for doing it this way, that's basically all you really need to be able to do is move your tracks around, cut ranges out, and then, you know, adjust the volume levels by locking and unlocking your tracks and using these buttons here. If so happens that you have audio that is not clear, you can click on this audio enhancement link, and it'll bring up some tools that you can use to affect the volume levels, like noise removal, and you can go to more options down here, and you can optimize your recording for male or female voice, which sometimes just removes some of the bass levels on your sound capture. And you can also remove clipping or clicks if you happen to have a source that's not exactly clean. And you can also do an even out the volume levels, which will attempt to smooth out large variations in your audio tracks to make it sound a little smoother. I don't really use them because the sound capture is actually pretty good the way it is, but you can also adjust the variation levels too. So then once you're done with that, you go ahead and hit OK, and when it's time to produce the video, you'll go ahead and say produce video as, and it'll give you some options for selecting what to produce. I'm going to go ahead and reopen this project by going to the Open Project button here, and then we're going to say no, we don't want to save, and we'll go back to episode 6, and it'll reload our project, which has already been produced and lined up and ready to go. So when you're to this state and ready to produce your video, you go to the Produce Video As button here, and it'll bring up the production presets window. And what we'll do is do a custom production setting and select, I use WMV for Windows Media Video. I've had the best luck with this particular setting, creating small file sizes that are of good quality and that behave with YouTube's restrictions. So when you're ready to do that, you can go ahead and hit next, and you have, you know, the option also of creating MP3s of the video or of the audio as well, but we won't be doing that. You can select file profiles based on what type of video you want to create and where you're going to be storing it. This particular one will be using just the best quality and file size, which is recommended. Adding index to the file to allow people to seek throughout, and then go to next down here. We'll stick with the preset video size of 640 by 480. For file size reduction, you can disable callout fades and zoom and pan to reduce the file size if that's your concern. You can also customize the size depending on where you're going to host it. And then when you're done, basically you're not going to be doing any watermarks or anything like that unless you've got something special to put in your video. And then when you hit next, this will be where you include things like table of contents or credits or anything that's interactive to the viewer. And then once you've decided on that, you go to next, and this is where you'll put your production file name, where you're going to store it, and where the final product will end up. And this process can take, I don't know, about 20 minutes depending on your file size. So once you're done, you should have a finished product that you'll be able to, oops, not in there, you'll be able to have a finished product that you can upload to YouTube. And this has been the tutorial on how to make a Let's Play video using the Pinnacle Studio, Dazzle DVC-170, and Camtasia Studio. So I thank you all for watching, and if you have any questions, don't hesitate to send me a message. I'll do my best to help you out. I hope this has been informative to you, and I look forward to seeing you all again on my next episode. So thanks again. Thanks for watching.